www.teresawalsh.org.
You're listening to KPFA, KPFB in Berkeley, or KFCF in Fresno, or on the web at kpfa.org. A big thank to you, everyone, who pledged and volunteered during KPFA's fall fund drive. We ended 3 days earlier than last year and only a few $1,000s short of our $1 million goal. You can still pledge securely online at kpfa.org, where you can choose from a list of all the thank you gifts we offered during the drive. That's kpfa.org. It's 7 p.m. Up next, Full Circle. Stay with us.
You're traveling through another dimension.
An area not only of sound and ideas, but light.
You're taking a journey to a land without boundaries, where diversity rules.
A dimension that is both multicultural and intergenerational.
You are moving into a field of empowerment and expression.
You are crossing into Full Circle.
Welcome to Full Circle. Last week, we heard excerpts from the Power to the Peaceful Festival held last month at Golden Gate Park in San Francisco. The event featured Michael Franti and Spearhead, Saul Williams, Angela Davis, and others. To hear archives of our show, go to www.kpfa.org. Our fund drive ended this morning, and we want to thank all of you who called in for your support. Thank you very much.
Tonight's show will look at the role of culture and how it brings communities together through music and communal celebrations. We'll explore a genre of music called free improvisation. We'll hear an interview with socially conscious hip-hop artist Kanon and take a look at how an organization in New Orleans is working to rebuild their musical culture. And finally, we'll have a live panel discussion about Dia de los Muertos and its historical, cultural, and political impact in San Francisco's Mission District. We are your hosts, Esther Mania and Antonio Ortiz. Stay tuned.
Does that sound like music to you? I don't know if it does to me, but it does to some, and it's called Free Improvisation. That was William Parker off his CD Testimony. A little bit about free improvisation. It is music without boundaries. First recognized in the 60s, it can borrow elements from many forms of music like rock or jazz. The main distinction of free improv is that nothing is planned in advance before making the music. The sound that comes out is the sound that comes out, and it could be looked at as each musician's self-created language. In the next piece, producer Veronica Moscoso explores the genre of music, this genre of music, through the story of Sudhu Tewari. He is a free improv musician who produces unusual electronic sounds through a unique musical instrument he created himself.
I think one of the funniest things is that this stuff that we do that we call music, which I consider music, a while ago, some of my friends can listen to what I do and some can't. And one friend of mine likes my music quite a bit, and I said, hey, take this CD, and I just wanted to get a sense of what people thought of it, the CD we had produced. I said, take this and play it in your car when people are there and ask them what they think about the music. And so, a couple months later, I remembered, I'd asked him, hey, what do people say about my music? And he was like, man, I hate to tell you this, but the overwhelming response was, dude, I think something's wrong with your speakers.
Sudhu Tewari is a musician who plays free improvisation music. This type of music, as its name suggests, is improvised without any particular style, and the rules are beyond the taste of the musicians involved. Free improvisation is considered a musical genre and also a technique. It developed mainly in Europe in the mid and late 60s, largely as an outgrowth of free jazz and modern classical music styles. Sudhu Tewari is one of the 21st century sons of the free improvisation movement. He inherited the passion to go for it and improvise without fear. His room looks more like an electrician's studio, with his computer living underneath his loft bed. Hanging from the ceiling are the inside parts of mixing boards, and the walls are packed with parts bins, mixing circuit wires, as well as pictures and much more. By using the technology of our times, he has put together and developed a unique instrument.
The instrument is a stereo receiver that a friend of mine found in a dumpster, and I gutted it, took all the electronics out of it because it didn't work.
The instrument looks like a box of electronics with a bunch of strings attached to it. The music that you're listening to comes from this instrument. I was curious to know if, apart from this, he played any other instruments.
Every single thing is an instrument, so it's hard to say that I play any one instrument or more than one instrument or how many I play, because everything becomes an instrument if you want it to be. So you can take a piece of wood and call that an instrument, and then I can say I play that too. So limitless numbers of instruments.
Yes, everything is an instrument. And what is the name of the instrument that Sudhu created?
No name. That's the other thing. So on one hand, you have anything can become an instrument. And so if you build an instrument, it's just the same as anything. So I built a thing, which is a box of electronics. It's a big metal box with springs on it. That's what I call it. You know, to simplify it, we call it the modified stereo receiver. But I don't like attaching a big name to the instruments that I build, because anyone can build it, and it's the same as, like I said before, a block of wood. I put some things together, I glued some springs to a box, and I call it an instrument, and I play it. But I don't want to call it the hydrocosmic whirly gizmotron, because it's not something super special.
Free improvisation is relatively little known, and the sound of Sudhu's instrument is unusual for most of us. However, he plays with different bands.
I have three bands, one of which is still sort of on hiatus. So it's this is a band from 4 or 5 years ago called CMAU, which stands for the Contact Mics Arts Union. It's a free improv group, four of us, a quartet. Two of the group play laptop. I play my modified stereo receiver, and Doug Michael plays an instrument he's built several times that's a... it's kind of like a koto. It's built on top of a walker, geriatric walker. We've got a big board across the top, and then he's strung guitar strings over the top. And he's made one with a bass guitar neck and a guitar neck, so he can play, because he's a guitarist, so he can do those sorts of things. And then he has fans and wheels and Velcro and all sorts of things attached. But the basis of that group is that we kind of use contact mics to amplify sounds and then manipulate those same sounds. So that's a total free improv group. Then I've been playing with a group named Tolga, which is three of us, myself, Mark Barcher, and Cenk Ergun. Mark and Cenk both play laptop, and then I play my instrument. And again, we tend to be pretty noisy. We like to call ourselves the Brutal Noise Heroes, and it's straight free improv again. And then I also play as a duo with Fred Frith, the guitarist, and we call ourselves Normal, and same free improv.
Free improvisation music pushes the boundaries of what is established as music. The creation of improvised sounds can go beyond melody, technique, harmony, and instruments. Anything approaching a conventional song is highly uncommon in free improvisation. There is generally more emphasis placed on mood and texture than on melody, harmony, or predictable rhythm. These elements are improvised at will as the music progresses. In other words, for the musicians, it's like having a blank canvas in front of them. I asked some people to forget about any musical ideas they had, to strip away the layers of civilized sophistication and just enjoy the sound for its own sake.
Quasars, the electronic noises that planets and solar systems make, that the radio astronomers pull out. And so I guess for me it felt very chaotic. I couldn't find a pattern in the sound. It made me feel tense because I was constantly seeking some continuity and it was never there.
It reminded me of a broken keyboard I used to have where there was this horrible sound in the background that was just a humming buzz that I could never get off of any of my recordings. I couldn't, like, really tell if that was music.
It's really reminded me of a science fiction horror movie. Drew a kind of emotions for me of, like, anticipation and kind of anxiety and this, oh, something bad is about to happen in the movie. It's going to be really scary. But it did kind of evoke more emotion in some ways because it was so raw.
If I had heard it without you saying listen to this music, I probably wouldn't have associated it with music. Because I'm so used to hearing music as, you know, patterns and things like that. But when listening to it, I felt like I was in a jungle. Like it was like, you know, when you go to a jungle, there's animals and sounds of wind and water and, you know, just things. I probably wouldn't have it in my CD player, but I think there's a place for everything. And I think that type of music has its place.
They really inspire me, some kind of confusion, collapse. I can think of something exploding or being destroyed. So this is powerful. That's how I feel it. It is very different.
Because free improvisation music is what it is, at the beginning you might think it's odd, but someone else might think it's the best thing they've ever heard. It might or might not be your taste, but hey, don't we need to throw off the shackles of convention to create? For Full Circle, I am Veronica Moscoso.
Thanks, Veronica, for that piece. It definitely makes you listen to music in a whole different light, literally. This past August, 20,000 people from all over the world convened in Caracas, Venezuela, for the 16th World Youth and Student Festival. This festival dates back to 1948 and has been a venue for youth to organize around various political issues. This year's theme was for peace and solidarity. We struggle against imperialism and war. This week-long festival featured a hip-hop summit that explored issues such as the role that hip-hop plays in anti-imperialism struggles, among other themes. The festival also highlighted musical performances by Dead Prez, Immortal Technique, Aslan Underground, and Kanon, just to name a few. And it truly exhibited the power that music has and its ability to bring diverse cultures together despite language or cultural barriers. I had a chance to interview the Somali-born rapper Kanon, and he talks about how he uses hip-hop as a socially conscious outlet that fuses the political with the personal.
Peace, this is Kanon, the Dusty Foot Philosopher. I reside in Toronto, originally from Mogadishu, Somalia, which translates the River of Blood. That neighborhood is probably the most dangerous neighborhood in the whole world. So I too was a refugee about 13 years ago when
I left the River of Blood at the height of the war. A song called Soba, which is talking to the warlords and the gunmen that have, like, caused so much civil strife. And I'm asking them on behalf of all the people that no longer want war to come out of where we come from. This is what Soba means.
Basically, I got beef. I want to talk to you directly. I can't ignore. I can't escape. And as such, you affect me.
What I'm saying in the chorus line, I'm singing in Somali. And what I'm saying is, that's kiwa dipte nagala soba. You've exasperated the people, so come out with it. Dip kiwa bate nagala soba. The troubles have increased, so come out with it. Di kiwa kote nagala soba. You've spilled the blood, so that now it rolls and balls, so come out with it. Du kiwa dipte nagala soba. You've burned the root of the earth, so come out with it.
I got beef, I wanna talk to you directly. I can't ignore, I can't escape. And as such, you affect me.
You cripple me,
you shackle me. You shatter my whole future in front of me. This energy is killing me. I gotta let it pour like blood soba.
Nafikiwa dite nagala soba. Nifikiwa bate nagala soba. Nifikiwa kute nagala soba. Nifikiwa kute nagala soba. Nagala soba.
So for real, who's to blame? We lose lives over Kabil's name. Disregard for the soul. We just don't give up no more. Left alone, all alone. Settle your issues on your own. What to do, where to go? I gotta be a refugee, damn soba. Mogadishu used to be a place where the world would come to see. Jazeera, Sugun Talida, Wadigle, Iyo Medina, Hargeisa, Bosaso, Bardere, Iyo Berbera. My skin needs to feel the sand, the sun. I'm tired of the cold, goddamn soba.
Namkiwa, dite, nagala soba. Nimkiwa, bate, nagala soba. Nikiwa, bute, nagala soba. Lumkiwa, bute, nagala soba. Nagala soba.
I guess I could use the last part of flow, known as a lyrical rhyme domino. I'm cynical, well, now you know, put a hole in an MC like Cheerio. They don't hear me though, I work for the struggle, I don't work for dough. I mean what I say, I don't do it for show. Somalia needs all gunmen, right out the door.
I was.
Can you talk about that process a little?
Well, it is a process of despair. It's hard to articulate disparity. So yeah, it's just like anything. It's just like leaving what you know in drastic terms and having to deal with something that you don't know, which also, you know, has its own historical biases about you that you have to learn and have to try and coexist with. So it's just, it's too much to explain what it's like.
How has, like, hip-hop, the art of expression, been a tool for you to sort of, you know, purge that whole process out?
It came at a necessary moment in my life where it is, like, you know, the only way to articulate these sorts of things is through the process of hip-hop. And it's been real relevant
and necessary more than anything else. For me, it wasn't even music. It was just a form of coming to terms with things, you know. So I use hip hop, and it uses me, you know, for these reasons.
And do you see it as a tool for organizing and sort of reinstilling a consciousness in the youth that are listening today?
A consciousness? I'm not sure. A sense of honesty, I think. For me, that is different from, this idea of the broad idea that is understood for what is consciousness. I am only a narrator of a time, of a place, you know, and of issues that affected our struggle in great deal. And all I'm doing is trying to paint those times.
How is this conference, this festival, has been for you?
It's been amazing. We got to just fill out the country, the people. I'm happy to be here at this time as well, because it is a place that is holding a certain position in the world of dignity for what they've been able to do in their political process to try to find an economic balance between the people who historically have been, caused to, separate because of injustices. I like that they're taking the first step, so I'm happy to be amongst a proud community for that reason. And I think that sense of patriotism has a way to define a nation thereafter. It can be to bad or to good, you know, and that is ultimately the decision and the synchronicity of the struggle of the past and the hopes of the future, and how people can find a line between that. And I think that I'm hoping that this place becomes an example for the rest of the world, for us who live in other parts of the world who want change.
Are you coming to the States anytime soon?
Yeah, I hope to be. We've been getting a lot of love from there. I hope to make it out, but to try to, thoroughly tour over there in a bit.
Someone wanted to check out your music. Can they buy it online? Or?
Yes, they can. And it's at thedustyfoot.com.
And is there anything you'd like to say to the youth listening to hip-hop?
Yeah, I don't really have words of wisdom to part to anyone as I'm learning, but I just think the same things I often say to myself, and it is, seek justice in a dignified manner.
And that was an interview with Kanon, the Dusty Foot Philosopher, recorded live at the 16th World Youth and Student Festival in Caracas, Venezuela. We have 3 CDs to give away to some of our listeners, and we'll go ahead and take callers 7, 9, and 12. So give us a call at 510-848-4425. Again, that's 510-848-4425. And we're looking for callers 7, 9, and 12. For Full Circle, I'm Esther Mania.
Everything wrong in my arrogance. Walk down the stairs, pissing cops, cause they're bitching. Life isn't fair, singing blues in my rap, dripping. Who's out the blood, sinking? He's down to earth, thinking. Leave out a Nerf chicken. I should run forfeiting everything I know. Listen, I was
misdirected.
I was.
Walk on.
Unheard.
I'm the message.
I'm the prolific remaining
author
from the gutter.
Was my girlfriend
when
he was younger.
I was Scar Joe.
Bullet.
I survived though. It came easy. The game needs me. Never let him see me down. Smile while I'm bleeding.
You're struggling. You're in jail. You're dead broke. In the ring too. We got friends now. No one knows you.
Never let him see you down. Smile while you bleeding.
When he needs you. The girl he needs. Mother's cry to tears you do. Let's fight the war, fight the pain, yo.
Never let him see you down. Smile while you bleeding.
My man currently in prison. I can't speak your name. It hurt me that you never listen. It can't be the same. I had to grow my intuition. Had me deep in pain. Cause I knew my options were either broke or the prison chains. I can't do it. I can't see it. Look, damn it. I can't blow it. I got judges telling me my life's key. They will throw it. No, sir. I plan to have a chauffeur. And it seems to me this chopping crack is really going nowhere. Therefore, they call me. I infect you with the real. That's the beef lies ahead to God. Spit so sick. I skid out. I'm falling. I'm out of luck. And I'm trapped. But I get out.
Can you help me? I'm going crazy.
My mind plays tricks. And I beat on floors like Bushwick. My fist bloody and blisters. The pair like I'm ballistic. I just stare at the red and smile while I'm bleeding.
head grow, mom. And the rings do, mom. We got friends now, mom. No one knows you. Never let him see you there, smile while you bleeding, mom. When he leaves you, mom. The girl needs you, mom. Anything a mother's pride to tell you.
Taking accounts, I'm not an insane. I've never been a clown. I was born where the mothers give birth while they frown. I'd walk with the kids that would sound. Never really thought I'd make it to 14. And anybody wanted a fight, I was most keen. Plus, I had a little temper, it was often 14. Yo, say something about my mama, I shoot you, get out clean. But you gotta keep in mind that I grew up in Mobisher. The only law was gun law, and we don't walk with pistols. You get laughed at for being so insensitive to the environment. Cause how will you be heard when them big boys is firing? War is no place for a child, especially if he's rolling with an AK and a smile. He had witnessed his own mother bloodying a tie. But please, please, never let him see you there and smile while you're bleeding.
You're struggling, mom. You're in jail, mom. You're dead bro, mom. And the rent's due, mom. Ain't got friends now, mom. No one knows you.
Never let him see you there and smile while you're bleeding,
mom. When he leaves you, mom. The girl needs you, mom. Anything a mother's pride to tell you to do, mom. Just fight the war, mom. Fight the pain, yo.
Never let him see you there and smile while you're bleeding,
mom. You're struggling, mom. You're in jail, mom. You're dead bro, mom. And the rent's due, mom. Ain't got friends now, mom. No one knows you.
Never let him see you.
They're all gone. Music has long played an influential role in our history and has proved itself powerful during pivotal moments such as Vietnam and the civil rights movement. Up next, we redirect our focus on a place that has long been... Up next, we redirect our focus on a place that has long been an inspirational breeding ground for musicians and artists. New Orleans, that's the place. Music to many has a close relationship to everyday life, but most of us don't see this until it's gone. Not only did Hurricane Katrina physically destroy the city, but it also devastated the historic musical scene of New Orleans. Hurricane Katrina displaced thousands of residents, including many musicians. Recently, I spoke with Juan Labastri of the Katrina's Piano Fund, an organization that's sole purpose is to rebuild New Orleans' long-revered musical culture. Juan speaks with us about its mission and about ways to get involved with this project.
A lot of people like myself lost a lot of things, and personal effects. The infrastructure of the city is still not nearly up and running. It's just a mess. And on top of what the hurricane took from me, I got back home to start rebuilding, only to find last weekend my studio was broken into and a lot of my guitars and editing equipment was stolen.
Oh, that's terrible. How has the music scene been affected by the hurricane?
Well, I kind of liken it to if you had a handful of pebbles and you threw them around your yard and you came back like a week later to try to find them all. The musicians from New Orleans have been strewn around the country. I mean, everywhere from New York to Los Angeles to, I spoke to one in Vancouver. Houston has a lot, Baton Rouge. They're just spread out so far. And, We have been contacting a lot of them to get them back into their craft. I found one guy that was a waiter in Houston to support his family. We got a guitar in his hand, and he's on a tour now.
So your goal is to try to get most of these musicians back? Is there a fear that most of them won't come back?
Well, there'll always be a percentage, but you know what we have going for us is something that nobody can change. Time can't even change. New Orleans is a mythical city. It's a city that I'm in love with. I've lived in five other major cities like New York, Los Angeles, Nashville, Tennessee, West Palm, Florida. New Orleans is a special place, and I have to be here.
Okay, so let's go into the Katrina Piano Fund. How did it get started, and why did it get started?
Well, when I left New Orleans after the storm, I stayed a few days after the storm to help the rescue efforts, and I made my way to New England and partnered with, I was hired by Klondike Sound Company to do a festival in New Jersey. And it was at that festival that we said, you know, we have to do something to help the music scene. And we brainstormed, thinking that the cornerstone of the New Orleans economy are the oil and gas industry and tourism. Well, we don't know anything about oil and gas, so tourism, the cornerstones of that is the food and the music. Mm-hmm. We're not restaurateurs, so music is what we know and what we do. And we had to find the niche in the music industry. We're non-producers. We're all audio guys. I think of it in terms of how it affected me. I left New Orleans with the clothes on my back and what I had in my pocket, and that was soaking wet. And a musician without his axe is like a carpenter without a hammer and a saw. I mean, you know, the old adage, I think it goes, you give a guy a fish, you feed him for a day. You teach him how to fish, you feed him for a lifetime. You know, you put the musicians in touch with what they need to make a living, and they become a part of an upward spiral economy rather than dependent on that economy to give them handouts. You give them their pride, you give them their craft, you give them a smile, and you give us something that we need, music.
So it's better to give them the instrument that's their livelihood as opposed to just giving them money, essentially.
Most definitely, most definitely. And we've been pretty good so far. We have almost a zero overhead. The lawyers who put together our corporation, the accountant that got the 501(c)(3) status, are all working pro bono. We have a instrument exchange program going, but we'd much rather cash donations because we can affect people in different cities without having to pay shipping or double shipping. And, you know, we go to the music stores. Let's say you're in Houston, Texas, or Albuquerque, New Mexico, and you need a trumpet. Well, I'll find out the location and the name of a local music store that you can get this trumpet or flute or whatever from, and I contact them and convince them to give it to us at cost. I pay for it. You pick it up, zero shipping. The store owner has done a good thing for Katrina and the musicians. We've done a good thing for the musicians. And artists have got an axe to play on and make money.
How many musicians have you helped?
Well, I can't give you a number straight off, but I can say in a neighborhood of $40,000 worth.
And what does this mean to the music scene or the culture of New Orleans, just the work that you're doing with the Piano Fund?
Well, you know, like I said, the musicians are spread all over the place. And along with that, they don't have the camaraderie, they don't have the support system that they have when they were together here in New Orleans. So we have to help them to rebuild that. And one of the ways we're doing that is to give them their instruments so that they can go back to work and reunite and do the things that they know to do best. Think about the music that's come out of this town. I mean, from Fats Domino, Tush Washington, Dr. John, Alan Toussaint, the brass bands, the Nevilles. I mean, Ziggy Boo Mona Lisa pretty much invented funk. Dixieland music, you know, the Mahalia Jackson, gospel. I mean, New Orleans has touched people in every way, in every genre. Fats Domino crossed over in the 50s. Blueberry Hill, I'm walking to New Orleans. We just can't let this stop. Can't let it spread and disseminate and filter into the rest of the country. This is our culture. This is our music. And we want to share it with everybody. But we have to keep it whole to really do what we do best.
So music in New Orleans has a very tight relationship. And how is this process of giving back instruments to musicians going to help in the recovery process?
Man, music heals all wounds. I can't stress that, man. You know, when you don't have anything else, you have the blues. Music can, a jazz funeral. And that's in a lot of places the saddest time in a person's life when they have to bury a loved one. Brass band can pick up your spirits right there. We not only want music, we need music here. Music is a part of our life from kids, man. You can go on street corners and see kids with trumpets and trombones and a hat, you know, honing their crafts to become the Wynton Marcelluses and the Delfield Marcelluses and you know, the Alan Toussaints of tomorrow. I mean, we have brass bands here that at the drop of a hat, will be up and running without microphone, without PA, without a plug, without electricity, without anything except their instruments. And we've pretty much outfitted two brass bands. I keep going back to what we're doing because it's kind of part of my life. It's my therapy. It's what I do to keep myself going right now.
So before we end the segment, can you please tell our listeners how they can get involved and where they can get more information about the Katrina Piano Fund?
I guess two things that I'd like to say. One would be that whatever fundraising organization, nightclubs, whatever, if they wanted to do anything, It would be good to directly hire New Orleans musicians and pay them like they've never been paid before. That would be a direct way of helping. Another thing is, I'm not trying to cold water the Red Cross or Salvation Army or anything, but they have overhead. They have operational costs. We have almost none. So it's almost dollar for dollar that's going into the musicians. Please just go to katrinaspianofund.org. That's Katrina's like plural, pianofund.org. And email me directly or touch the PayPal button. And like I said, think of it in terms, personal terms, not in terms of people thousands of miles away that need some help. This is something that, you know, everyone in this country, I'm sure, barring a very few, has enjoyed and listened to music that's come out of New Orleans. And we just want to make sure that that just doesn't end with a hurricane.
And so thank you so much, Juan, for giving us information about the Katrina Piano Fund. And for Full Circle, my name is Antonio Ortiz.
Thank you, Antonio. Thanks in advance to everyone.
And that was a song, Johnny Billy Goat, by Buzu Chavez. You're tuned into Full Circle, and tonight we are talking about the role that music and culture play in bringing communities together. We are your hosts, Antonio and Esther.
We now return our attention to a local celebration of the arts and culture that is held each year. Many people look at death as a sad and morbid event, a topic to be avoided and forgotten. But for many Latino communities, death is something that is viewed as a natural cycle, an event to be celebrated and honored. Día de los Muertos, otherwise known as Day of the Dead, is celebrated on November 1st, which is known as All Saints Day, and November 2nd, which is referred to as All Souls Day. There are many events that coincide with these dates in the Bay Area. This SF Mission procession takes place on November 2nd, and there's a celebration coming up in the Fruitvale in Oakland this Sunday, October 30th. Tonight, we'll explore the history and cultural significance of Dia de los Muertos for Latino communities and how it transcends politically, particularly in the Mission area.
We'd like to welcome to our studio Rosa de Anda, a Bay Area artist of the Marigold Project, who is one of the organizers of the 24th annual procession held in the Mission of San Francisco. Also with us, Carrie Cordova, American Studies scholar and lecturer at UC Davis. Her dissertation is titled The Heart of the Mission, Latino Art and Identity in San Francisco. And we'd like to also welcome Patricia Rodriguez, gallery coordinator and curator at the Mission Cultural Center. I know it's a very busy time of year for you all, considering Dia de los Muertos is just around the corner, so we thank you for coming and welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So I'd like to project the first question to Rosa. For our listeners who may not know about Dia de los Muertos, can you briefly talk about its origin?
Well, I can talk about its origin in terms of what we do in San Francisco and how we got to celebrate Dia de los Muertos in San Francisco. I know that its origins are thousands of years old. It's a Mayan, Aztec, and the entire Mesoamerican continent that celebrated Dia de los Muertos by providing a segue for the souls to come back to visit them. And here in San Francisco, we have tried to recreate the same feeling, but extend it to all of the community, which is not just Latino community, but African American, Asian, the entire Bay Area. So it is the first place that was celebrated in the United States, San Francisco. And so I feel very, very honored to be part of that.
Okay, well, thank you, Rosa.
And Patricia, would you like to add anything to that?
Yes, I'd like to, before the audience calls, make a correction. The first place that it was celebrated was in Los Angeles by group that does prints. What was the name of the group?
Self-Help Graphics.
Self-Help Graphics started it in the streets, in the procession, and all the face painting and the altars. And it came up to the Bay Area by Renee Yanez and other
groups. If I could
I'm sorry, if I could just spin off of that just a little bit, just to say that Dia de los Muertos had a very strong presence in private celebrations.
That's right.
So a lot of people were celebrating Dia de los Muertos before these public celebrations started. They were very familial. It's really just that in the 70s, early 70s, with the concept of the Chicano movement, that we opted to transform the celebration and make it more public as an opportunity to express a political and a community identity.
Correct. And a lot of times things happen simultaneously, so people want to take ownership because it's a pride matter. But it is true that it grew out of people's homes, like it has in Mexico itself.
Exactly.
I'm glad both of you touched on those issues, because that's where my next question is going to be directed to. I have a, you know, it's rooted in indigenous celebration and also just very personal ones in the home. But there's a difference from, you know, something that's very personal and happening in the home to being transcended into an urban setting, such as the one that we see in the mission. Can Rosa talk about that a little bit?
Yes. My experience has been that my focus has been in trying to create themes around Dia de los Muertos that people can relate to. This year, we're celebrating spiritual diversity in our community, and that's the focus of the Festival of Altars in San Francisco, and that's the focus that the Marigold Project, which is the project that I work with, will take to the procession and bring back to the public altars, which, by the way, anybody is welcome to come and place an altar to commemorate their loved ones, their ancestors. Please join us.
So Rosa, can you talk a little bit about the altar, the altars? How many altars are there and what they signify?
Well, we have tried to create a sacred space for the community, and that's to be interpreted as free and as open as anyone would like to make it. But the way we have created sacred space is by calling in the directions with five giant altars that symbolize each direction. For instance, we put up an altar for East, and we celebrate the children's, the little babies that have died. We celebrate their souls, and we set up this altar at eye view for children, and the color is white. The symbolism that we use is a circle. It's all spirit. And we move on to the South, which is where we celebrate teenagers. We at one point celebrated the killings in the mission done by youth. And at that year, that altar became their altar and their peace and their excitement. It was truly on fire. It is where we celebrate fire. It is where we celebrate the youth. We associate that altar with the triangle, and it's all about passion, it's all about love, it's all about poetry. And then we move to the West, where it's water that we pay homage to, and we pay homage to the adult section of the dead. And this is the area where we celebrate commitment, we celebrate tides, we honor water. We this year is especially a difficult altar, because we were trying to restore the good that water does, and so we're working very hard to make that visible, and at the same time honor the people that we have lost through water. And then we have North, and North is the altar that we set up for ancestors. It's the altar that's usually the most recognizable, because a lot of these altars are very non-traditional and large and stunning. But in the North, we usually keep it very traditional, and we celebrate the earth, and we celebrate the seeds. We celebrate the full circle of life, from birth to teenagehood to adulthood to ancestors.
So thank you, Rosa. I just wanted to pull Patricia in on this topic as well. We've mentioned altars, but for many people, they don't really know what goes into altars, the symbolism behind it, the things that are involved, and how that connects to their loved ones. So Patricia, if you can expand on, you know, the intricacy of an altar.
Well, it's a very personal thing. I think the altars are done in the home for your parents that have passed or your relatives or your ancestors. And then if the artist, the other transition that has become very popular is to have the artist do an altar in a public venue, which is maybe the park with Rosa or the Oakland Fruitvale area or in the gallery. And once it's in the gallery, it becomes a fine art piece. It's either an installation or an altar that's being dedicated, a contemporary altar that's been dedicated to somebody special from the community. And what goes on the altar is very personal. It's things that that person liked, whether it's tequila, cigar, or noodles. It all goes on the altar. And if it's a combination of people that are working together, then it becomes either very funny or it can be very personal or very beautiful. And then there's foods that are also traditional that go on the altar, mole, tamales, or maybe a chocolate or pan de muertos.
Okay, thank you so much, Patricia. Just for our listeners who are tuning in, you are listening to Full Circle on KPFA 94.1 FM. Before that was Rosa de Anda of the Marigold Project, and I'm going to redirect this question back to Patricia of the Mission Cultural Center. So, Patricia, many artists look forward to this time of year. It's definitely an inspirational time. Can you talk about the way the celebration has transformed into an art form of itself?
It's become very popular over the years, and so the transition has been from traditional altars that was very common in the early 70s and 80s to much more contemporary art now. And in those installations, people talk about a wider range of concepts and areas, such as the dedication to a flood, the Katrina victims or war victims, or people in general that have died in the street. And so the elements also change. It's no longer an altar. Maybe it's an installation depicting spirit, light, or life. And it can be very beautiful. A lot of elements are used that are electrical lights or special settings or color or transparency of different types of plastic materials. And they're all still very beautiful.
Yes, I look forward to it each year. This question is for Carrie. I recently read an article on El Tecolote about recent demolitions and potential displacements. And this is something that, as we all know, the Mission area has been subjected to for quite some time. And many artists have already been displaced post-dot-com era. Carrie, can you talk about that impact that gentrification has had on artists and communities in the Mission and how, in turn, affects celebrations like this?
Oh, well, that's no small question. That's actually probably a leading question for what has generated my work on the Mission and on Latino artists in San Francisco. And I think part of my work, what has been most revealing to me, is looking at the instability of the Latino community in San Francisco over a much longer period of time, such as before the Mission, that we had other communities in San Francisco before the Mission, and that those have also been displaced, and that what you see happening with Latino culture is a willingness to sort of commodify it, to accept the culture, to purchase the food, to celebrate the fiesta, and at the same time discredit the people that create it, and a willingness to not recognize the peoplehood. And I mean, this concept is also tied to issues of immigration and nation and all these other concepts. In terms of tying that to Dia de los Muertos, what you see happening is that in some respects the event is easily commodified, that it can be sold and purchased, and it in some ways can become a nexus with Halloween and therefore becomes more of a party rather than a spiritual event. And so that also creates all these problems and concepts about who is celebrating this event and for who is it. So I you know, not to spin off into too many different areas there, but certainly you're bringing up a very large topic.
I know it's a pretty complex one, but I think it's one that, you know, we need to address from time to time. You mentioned the aspects of this event and this festival being, in a sense, commodified. So I want to throw this back to both Rosa and Patricia and sort of get your response on that. This Day of the Dead, this Dia de los Muertos festival is a multicultural event now.
Yes, for me, I have always promoted that. And I stand by it because death is the only thing we all share. And I am not for charging money at galleries for this event. I'm not for Marigold Project and the procession and its Festival of Altars has never accepted any corporate funding. We want it to maintain itself as a community-supported venue where people can come and express themselves. It is the only holiday that I object to calling artists professionals because it gives everyone the opportunity to be creative and to make it a spiritual experience, which is what art is supposed to be in the first place. So this is when everybody can be an artist and be any color and be any age.
Patricia, what are your thoughts on that?
The community in large has always come forward to express what they feel about Dia Los Muertos. And the Mission Cultural Center, for example, has always been open to the tia who comes in last minute and says, you know, my husband has just passed away. Can I have a little corner someplace to do an altar? And we always open the door to that kind of request. But because the Mission Cultural Center has also become very popular exhibition venue for a lot of things, a lot of artists come in with beautiful altars and they want to go more contemporary. So it's a whole different, it has taken a whole different venue. It's gone a different way. I don't know if that answered your question.
Yes, it did. I'm sorry, so for our listeners who are just tuning in, this is Full Circle on KPFA 94.1 FM. And I'm Antonio, here with Esther, and we are speaking with Rosa de Anda of the Marigold Project, Carrie Cordova, American Studies Scholar and Lecturer at UC Davis, and Patricia Rodriguez of the Mission Cultural Center. So tonight we're talking about Dia de los Muertos, and there are many events coming up this week, or these 2 weeks, and so we'll start with Rosa. Can you briefly tell our listeners about the upcoming procession and how they can get involved?
You can get involved by calling 415-336-7336, and you can let us know if you plan to put up an altar at the corner of Treat and 25th or Harrison and 25th, or you can come, simply show up on that day, November 2nd. We'll be open from 8 o'clock till 5 o'clock where you can set up your altar any way you want. I'll be there. Other people will be there that have always been there and help you, direct you. Also, the procession begins at 7 o'clock promptly at the corner of Bryant and 24th. It's about 15-block procession. It culminates in the park. So it's beautiful. Bring your candles, pictures, and mementos of your loved ones. You will definitely feel their spirit.
Thank you, Rosa. Do you have a website that people can get information at?
It's dayofthedeadsf.org.
Okay, so dayofthedeadsf.org. And now we go to Patricia from the Mission Cultural Center, and it has many events lined up as well. Can you highlight some of those for our listeners?
Yes, the events that are coming up is November 2nd opening gala event. And once you come in, it'll be from 6 to 11 p.m. There is going to be a sugar skull maker, Emilio Quintana, who's going to be in the lobby doing sugar skulls. And then we have Felipe Horta, who's coming from Michoacan, who's going to be carving masks up on the second floor. We have the Aztec dancers performing and many other surprises that are taking place in the building. And on the 10th of November, we have our second annual mole contest, which Rosa de Anda created for us at Mission Cultural Center.
I was their guest curator last year.
And we thought it was a brilliant idea. We asked Rosa if we could continue with the tradition, and she says it would be great. And so we're going to try it again this year, and we invite people to come by and taste the mole from the community And as you know, Mole has an incredible history, and there's all colors, you know. There's, I think, white chocolate, dark chocolate,
yellow chocolate.
Mole.
There's,
I mean, it's green. It's incredible, wonderful. It's a potpourri for your taste buds. And but on the 16th of November, we have a very special guest, which is Carrie Cordova, and she's going to give a lecture, and then maybe she can talk about that.
Okay, but before we go to Carrie.
Yes, please go ahead and do that. Carrie?
Oh, okay, sure, I'd be happy to. It's quite an honor, actually, to be giving a talk with some of the people that have really been instrumental in developing Dia de los Muertos, the Day of the Dead culture in San Francisco. So I will be talking with René Yáñez, who was instrumental at Galería de la Raza in developing their celebration, along with Yolanda Garfias Wu, who really served as an authority within San Francisco as a sort of anthropological expert on Oaxaca, but also growing up and celebrating Day of the Dead with her family and bringing that knowledge to bear in the city. And then I'm also going to be speaking with Carlos Cordova, who is no relation, but he's a scholar at San Francisco State, and he actually, I believe, created an altar for the first celebration of Dia de los Muertos at the Mission Cultural Center. So, I mean, with these three people, it's quite easy for me to just allow them it's quite difficult, perhaps, for me to speak in front of them and give them my surmisal of exactly what has just transpired over the years. But that's what I'm going to attempt to do. And the focus of my lecture, I'm going to give a sort of overview of the history of Dia de los Muertos in San Francisco and how it's changed over time and how it has developed. But I'm also going to focus a lot on the 1980s as a turning point for this particular event in San Francisco, just because I think that through the 70s, what you saw was a sort of coming into familiarity with the celebration, learning about it, learning about the history of it within the city, and that a lot of the events around it centered around recreating the indigenous activities coming from Mexico, Peru, Central America, and that over the course of the 1980s, once there was this wider celebration of it, there was greater familiarity, and
Carrie, I'm sorry to cut you off there. It sounds like a really interesting, you know, panel, and I wish we can go more into it at the same time.
Sorry.
Again, that's happening Wednesday, November 16th at 7 to 9 p.m. at the Mission Cultural Center. I want to thank you all for coming in tonight and speaking with us about the Dia de los Muertos. It's definitely been an interesting conversation. I know we just scratched the surface on a lot of issues, and we appreciate all your work, you know, that you do every year. So, looking forward to the event. For more info about the upcoming events, please visit www.dayofthedeadsf.org or www.missionculturalcenter.org. We'll be right back after the Full Circle calendar.
Here's a listing of a couple of fun events you can participate in next week. On Wednesday, November 2nd, the World Can't Wait Drive Out the Bush Regime Rally and March will take place at noon at Civic Center Plaza in San Francisco. March organizers urge you to support this major protest against the Bush administration's war in Iraq. Gallery 1 San Francisco presents A Continuous Journey, Rebirth, Renacimiento, an indigenous Dia de los Muertos altar ceremony and exhibit. The exhibit is showing from now until November 5th at 1 Embarcadero Center, Suite 1. For more information, call 415-772-9008.
That wraps it up for tonight's show. Thanks for listening to Full Circle, a weekly magazine produced by the KPFA First Voice Apprenticeship Program. Full Circle airs Fridays from 7 to 8 p.m. Special thanks to our tech interns, Imogene and Puimon, and to our production interns, Carmen, Manguido, Nico, and Jin. Our technical director is Mickey Mays. Our segment editor is Rangita G. Our senior producer is Veronica Moscoso. Advisors are Anita Johnson and Amelia Gonzalez.
If you have any questions or topics for future shows, write us at 1929 Martin Luther King Jr. Way in Berkeley, California, 94704. Our email is fullcircle@kpfa.org. With Veronica at the control, we've been your host, Esther and Antonio.